الذي لا إله سواه الواحد الأحد الفرد الصمد الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا مولانا محمد وعلى آله صلاة تنجينا بها من جميع الأحوال والآفات وتزكينا بها من جميع الأحوال والشهوات وتطهرنا بها من جميع السيئات وتقضي لنا بها جميع الحاجات وترفعنا بها أعلى الدرجات وتبلغنا بها أقصى الغايات من جميع الخيرات في الحياة وبعد الممات. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. So to recap, we looked at Muraqaba, the first sitting that we had together, and the basics of that, that I should be aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Muraqabi, and that is an experiential awareness. We spoke about in the second sitting, the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's presence that I went to, experienced that with my qalb, of feelings of haya, of modesty, of khushur, of fear, of reverence, of khashya, of stillness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and of hub and mahabba and of love. And that experience of me knowing Allah is watching me is going to make me very careful and conscious of what's happening inside of my heart. And then yesterday we looked at searching for them. Divine signal, that we want to be in Muraqaba as a steady state, most of our day, if not all of our day. And in order to do that, we need to spend some quality time, quality khalwa with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the day, by which we focus all of ourselves on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we practice that. We practice connecting and focusing and gathering our qalb on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He is watching deep inside of our qulub. And the more that we do that, the more that we take time out to make that effort and that sacrifice of sitting and focusing our hearts on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then that has a spillover effect. That has a spillover effect outside of those moments of khalwa. So the ulama, they say, and they all say this unanimously, that there is no real tawbah, return with our hearts to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except after moments of khalwa. That if we're not taking time, personal time, to sit alone, to focus inward, to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's rare, if not impossible, that that person will ever generate a tawbah that is nasuha. The precondition for tawbah is obviously introspection and quiet and focus. Then we build up the strength to turn our hearts to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And like that, we will never really attain a steady state, qalbi, awareness of Allah watching us, unless we spend time to do that. And that time is the quiet moments of khalwa, and the most powerful of those lies in salah. Now, a question. So the question that I think would naturally arise in me, maybe in you, is, well, how do I focus? Did it come to your mind? How do I concentrate? Because the moment we start to do that, we realize that it's difficult to concentrate. It's difficult to focus the attention or the gaze of our heart on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala watching me. And I drift. I'm easily distracted. So after I sit for a while, a few minutes, I started to think this is hard work. How can I get better at focusing, better at concentrating? So today's topic, hafidhakumullah, is concentrate like a cat. Concentrate like a cat. So the inspiration of this is the story of Imam Junaid, rahimahullah. Imam Junaid was one of the greatest early scholars of law. He was a faqih and a jurist and a qadi. And he was one of the greatest early masters of the sciences of the qalb and tazkiyah. So much so that almost all of the various streams of tasawwuf, they all trace their lineage through Imam Junaid rahimahullah. He was even earlier than Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani, who was of the earliest generation. So he has this beautiful story that he tells and narrates about how he began his path of muraqabah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Imam al-Junaid was known for his path of muraqabah. And some of the teachers, when they mentioned the various paths to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there are very many. For example, Sidi Muhammad Amin mentioned something like 10 different ways to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all taken from the Quran and Sunnah with different emphases. So one of them that he mentions is the path of muraqabah, and it's the path of Imam al-Junaid, who was famous for that. So the story goes like this. Because of what Allah gave him of ilm, external and internal, and because of safa of his qalb and the purity of his qalb, he had many, many students. And his students asked him one day, they said, Ya Sayyidi, how did this all begin? How did Allah give you what Allah gave you of the treasures of his nearness? So he recounts the story. And he says, one day I was walking and I came across a cat. And the cat was stationed in front of the hole of a mouse. So I stopped and I watched. And I watched this cat sit transfixed on that hole, motionless, not moving a hair on its body, a muscle in its body, directed with full attention and concentration to the hole of the mouse, because he's waiting for the mouse to emerge, and when the mouse emerges, it's gonna pounce on it and have breakfast, lunch, or dinner. So he says, the more I looked at that, Imam Junaid rahimahullah, the more amazed I became. And then he says, subhanAllah, he said, a voice inside of me called out. A voice inside of me said something like, Ya Bani al-Himma, O you of such low, base resolution, resolve, drive, لا تجعل همتك أقل أو أدنى من همة الغيرة. Don't make your drive and your desire, obviously for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, less than the himma of the cat. ولا تجعل مطلوبك أقل أو أدنى من مطلوب الفأر. And don't make your goal and your aim less than the aim of a mouse. So that internal angelic voice said, you are seeking who? Allah. And look at the cat. Look at how it's devoting its energy, its singularity of purpose, practically now in searching for the rat, the mouse. So don't make your himma less than the hima of a cat when you are searching for the divine, the ultimate. And don't make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our quest for Allah, don't treat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala less than you would treat the prize of finding a meal. In this case, the cat looking for the rat. So he said, Afaqtu, I woke like I was in a slumber, or like I was sleeping, and I woke from that. And tadabbahtu, and I took a deep lesson with my qalb from that, and then I began what I began of turning my internal focus and energy towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as much as I could, wherever I could, and Allah gave me what He gave me. And he begins this, subhanAllah, in a beautiful way. He says, Mustadi fil muraqaba al-hira. His tawadu'a. He says, my sheikh in muraqaba was the cat. Sheikh in what sense? In that the idea of where is my hima? Where is my desire? Where is my drive? Where is my inner momentum? Where is my seeking? Where is my talab? So I learned that, he said, looking at a creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a sign, an ayah. Like Shaykhuna Khalil was speaking last night. Alladhina yadhkurun Allah, those who look at these signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they see everything, either the Quran, which is a direct written sign, his words, his speech, or the other signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these rijal, they see signs in everything. Everything is directing them and pointing them, indicating towards the divine subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything says something about my relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when he sees the cat, that's what he takes from it. And because he was who he was even before this, no doubt he was in dhikr of Allah Azza wa Jal. No doubt he had already focused on Allah Azza wa Jal. And because they were in dhikr, they could see the signs. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala links إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ and all of these signs أَلَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهِ because the people of Luqa, the people who remember Allah Azza wa Jal, and the remembrance of Allah Ta'ala allows them to penetrate and to see into the realities of things which otherwise they wouldn't have access to, because the eyes only see the surface, the qalb sees deeper. So he sees that, and what lesson is he taking? Well, many lessons, but let's look at three. How patient the cat was. You think the cat sits for a minute? 2 minutes? 3 minutes? The cat probably sat for a while. You know, we think, well, when I initially thought of the story, I thought he just sees it, wow, he's probably waiting and watching. And he just sees it still. Probably a while that's happening. It's not just a 5 minute encounter. So the patience of the cat, to the focus of the cat, not moving, no muscle, no hair, eyes that on the prize. And then 3 years, the himma of the cat, the desire of the cat. The cat wants it. He wants that mouse. That's my mouse. It's a matter of survival. And for us, it's more than survival. We need Allah Azza wa Jal more than... There's a story of one of the earlier ulama. And then his murid says, now we learned this morning about food and dunya. So his murid says, Ya Sayyidi, we need food. They must have been very hungry. He says, Ya Sayyidi, we need food. And the sheikh keeps quiet. Then he says, "Ya Sayyidi, we need food." Quiet. Then again, "Ya Sayyidi, we need food." So he looks up and he says, "We need Allah. We need Allah." So we need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than food, more than it's beyond the matter of survival, of existence, even more than existence perhaps. So when I look at this story, then I have to ask myself, well, where's my himmah? Where's my patience? Number two. Where's my focus? Number three. Where's my himmah? Where's my patience? If I say I want something, how patient am I in getting it? If I say I want something, do I really want it? How badly do I want it? And if I want something, how much am I concentrating and focusing on getting it? And we all have stories. Just like we look at the story of the important, beautiful, Allah-loving people in our life, and how their presence changes us. So Allah Ta'ala also gives us examples where we wanted something so badly and we forgot everything in pursuit. So one example, when some of the students asked Sayyidina Mukhtar about how do I concentrate, you know, in salah, in my focus in salah, in my moments of dhikr, in my moments of dua, of salawat, of tafakkur, how do I focus on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So he says, we don't ask the question how when it comes to other aspects of dunya. No one, for example, teaches us how to concentrate when we're writing an exam. This is a very powerful and profound example. You've written an exam? High school, college, university, even at work. Now, let's say the most important exam you wrote. High school, university, that's a make it break course. You don't get that course, you can't go on to the next year. Right? Or you've got to get certain results to get a position or posting. You know, you have to write the law school exams. And your mark on the exam now depends on what firm is going to take you. Because they look at those marks. And if you want a good firm, you have to have good marks. Or you do a new matric, want to apply to med school. And you know the pressures of application to med school. So when you sit for that exam, can you concentrate? All of us, can you?
No.
Yeah! Of course! Are you even aware of your surroundings sometimes? Often not. Are you even aware of time itself? Oh my God! An hour went by, and I still have, you know, most of this to do. The first time I wrote law exams, right? I'm a slow thinker. So, you know, doing that stuff very fast, because they give you sections, and then you have to race against the clock. So the first time, it was so difficult that I guessed everything. After 15 minutes, I just guessed it, and I got up, and the auditorium was filled with would-be lawyers, and they were focused. You could feel the mental stress in that room, you know? And then I got up, and I walked out confidently. I was a bit cheeky. And everyone was like, "Whoa, he's a genius," right? I just guessed it. Right? But we all have those experiences when you really, really, right, you can't even time. No concept of time. If there's a noise, you don't even hear it sometimes. You know, rustling of paper, you can't hear anything. And are you daydreaming in an exam? Do we ever daydream in an exam? Ever sit back in the exam? Let me just think now. You know, surfing. I hope it's a good wave. You know? No! Why? We have tremendous focus. And if we start thinking about surfing, you know, surfing a wave, the moment the thought comes, what do? Banish it. Back on the exam. So, we don't need to learn that. I mean, they teach you how to write the exam. They teach you tricks on how to do the questions. Do they ever teach you how do you focus? Is there ever a course like, you know, prep course for an exam? How do you focus? They say, you know, really want it. Really desire it. Know how important it is. Know the consequences. They don't tell you that. You know that naturally. You know how important it is. You know the consequences of doing well. You know the consequences of not doing well. Right? You want it. And because you really want it, you do it. So it's like that. You know, that cat really wanted the bag. You know, that's food. Food is life, survival. I have to have it. So how much do I really want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How much do I really want Him? How important is it to me? If it wasn't that important, if it is that important, then focus will be much easier, if not even easier. The more my himmah, the greater my focus. The more my himmah, the greater my focus. So think of, concentrate like a cat. Sometimes if I'm sitting, I do that. I think that, yeah, come on. At least be the cat. At least be the cat, if not more. And if you bring your, you know, if you think of the cat and you can imagine that scenario, it is inspiring. It is inspiring in terms of an ayah that we can learn from about focus and patience and himmah. So whether that is sitting in my private moments of khalwa, of dhikr of muhatabas, whether that is in my salah, or throughout my day, when I'm doing many things, and there are many things that are attracting me, the qalb can focus on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while it's doing many things. The proof of that is, you know, I can be working and I can be thinking of my children. I can be working and thinking of my parents. I can be working and thinking of my teachers. So we do have, the qalb has that, alhamdulillah, we have that ability that the qalb can be aware of something and we can be doing things. You know, the ulama teach us that many of them are speaking and they're in dhikr inside. It's just something that needs to be worked on and struggled for. Then in closing, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَالَّذِينَ جَاءُوا فِينا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. This is so beautiful. What does Allah want? وَالَّذِينَ جَاءُوا فِينا. So this idea of making jihad in us, for us, that encapsulates this idea of himmah. That we're struggling, and you know, struggling in spending money for Allah Azza wa Jalla is khayr, struggling for da'wah is khayr, struggling for Allah Himself. Imagine that. Jahad fina, we want Allah. Yes, we want Jannah, but Allah is the creator of Jannah. So we want Jannah and we ask for Jannah. But having Jannah is not like having the creator of Jannah. We have Jannah for the creator. It is not Jannah without Him. So, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا. Whoever wants Him and struggles for Him, Then Allah Ta'ala takes a qasam. La nahdiyannahum. Allah Ta'ala, in the most emphatic way that a verb can be, and you know that. That lam plus the noon that's emphasized, mushaddada mustaqqala, la nahdiyannahum. We will most definitely promise of Allah Azza wa Jalla. So whatever effort I bring, whatever little effort I bring, if it's for him to seek him, لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُ we will most. And Allah Ta'ala says, وَمَنْ جَاهَدُ وَلَلِّيَ جَاهَدُ فِيْنَا in us, to emphasize the ta'zeem, the other of Allah is to fina us. And then his power, لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُ we will. With that, subhanAllah, perfect jalal and jamal of him, we will guide them سُبُلَنَا to our ways, our pathways. And what could that mean? Wallahu a'lam. In everything we find Allah. I'm here, I find a path to you. I do that, a path to you. I do that, a path to you. Everywhere I look, there are paths that only lead to him. There are paths, but they all lead to him. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ And verily, certainly, Allah Azza wa Jalla, the emphasis on وَإِنَّ emphasis. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَ emphasis. مَا emphasis. مَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ Those who are seeking the path of ihsan, that's what this also means. Those who are seeking the path of ihsan, to worship Allah like they see them. They're traveling that path of jubil. So this is almost an ayah that's so beautiful that speaks to the path to Allah Azza wa Jal. And when we're walking that path to Allah Azza wa Jal, before we get to Allah Azza wa Jal, He's with us on the way. Right? Because we're making mujahada. And Allah Ta'ala says, وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ Those who are doing good and struggling for ihsan, I am with them. Ma'iyah of Allah Azza wa Jal, which is the intent of muraqabah and dhikr and salah, to feel Allah Ta'ala's ma'iyah, His presence. That we feel it in our qulub. وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ May Allah Azza wa Jal make us of those who take the path with focus, with concentration, with hikmah. And may Allah Azza wa Jal take us by the hand of the path. Not leave us to ourselves, to our own devices. Not leave us to our own effort. Not leave us to our own work. Not leave us to our own struggle. May He, by His ma'iyah, lead us to Him. After coming online from, at some moments, perhaps we continue with that. Sunnah that we started together, a few minutes of muraqabah, and then inshallah after that, to be dhikr and du'a until maghrib. SubhanAllah wa bihamdik, wa ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum.